Eagle Up Friday seminar series. My name is Rashad Mead. And just to kind of give everyone context, we started this series because we have to make sure that our community is informed, but also we have to show the power of this Eagle community. So right now we have scholars from all five of our schools, maybe some of our brothers from across the water in Newark are on as well. And the purpose of this is to really show you guys that people have a real interest and care in your voice. But at the same time, we want you to make informed decisions. We're bringing individuals who have power, influence, and also a very, very powerful story to kind of share with you on a consistent basis. And I'm very biased. I'm not even going to say I'm not biased. I'm very biased about who we have on with us today. No question about it. Very, very biased. Not just in title, but in respect, in work, and commitment to the uplifting of our community. But as always, we want to know that we're hitting the right marks. And we're going to do that by opening up with a poll, right? A series of polls. And just like last week, you know, even if you are not a scholar, you know, just think about a young man that this poll may relate to, and we want to get your vote. As you've been seeing across the country, your vote matters. So when you vote a certain way on these polls that we launch, it dictates what we present to you to ensure that we're making sure that we're hitting all the marks for you guys. So I'm launching a poll now. Let's get to voting, guys. So the question is, if you are a voting age, which of the following issues will be most important? Mind you, all of these issues are important, but which of these issues are the most important to you? So it's looking like a pretty even split is leaning towards funding for education. We're about halfway there. Let's keep voting, guys. Okay. I'll end the poll. And I'll share some of the results. So funding for education, that checks a big box for me, that's for sure, right? Coming in second, we have access to good hospitals and doctors. You guys are really following what's going on in our world with COVID. Policing, number three, and climate and change for the environment is number four. Thank you for that. So I'm gonna launch the second poll. So another very, very important question, where do you typically get your news/information from? Is it social media? Someone my age during a conversation, they're just putting you on to things? Are Eagle town halls or newspapers and news websites? There's a clear favorite in this one. We're almost there, about 70%. Like I said, your vote matters. This may dictate what we talk about next week or the following weeks. So I'm gonna share these results. So 58% of the participants on this webinar indicate that social media is where they get the vast majority of their information from, which makes complete sense in our world today. Newspapers and websites, number two. Eagle Town Halls, that's accommodation to, you know, Principal Velasquez, Principal Washington, Principal Hall, Principal Cameron, and Principal Simone. We're doing something right. We're doing something right. And then our final poll, and really take some time to think about this one. For future town hall sessions, what would you most like to hear about and discuss? How money works, sports and entertainment and how, you know, the influence of athletes and entertainers have on our community, college and career readiness, study skills, and being ready academically. Where do you fall? And any adult that's on right now, just think about a scholar that you interact with or a student you interact with on a consistent basis. Where would they lean? Just a way to capture everyone's thoughts and opinions. Okay. Share the results. Wow, this accommodation to Mr. Ruff, our director of college and career readiness. So 40% of our scholars indicate that college and career readiness, as well as how money works. Sports and entertainment with third, and study skills and academic readiness, number four. So gentlemen, every time we come on, we're gonna take like this litmus test where we kind of really gauge where you fall in terms of some of these really key issues. And we're gonna make sure that we craft town halls and future sessions that really speak to that. And the person kind of leading the charge and helping us get facilitators and speakers that are really gonna hit the mark and drive home what you need to know about is our founder and CEO, Mr. Banks. So Mr. Banks, give us a quick wave, if you don't mind.
All right. Great, it's gonna be a great conversation today with our guest speaker today. Excited to participate.
Thank you, Mr. Banks. So once again, I wanna thank everyone that's logged on today. I wanna thank every member of our Eagle community. And mind you, we want you guys, every time these links go out, it's not just the Eagle community that we want to access, this everyone. Any parent, any New York City resident outside of New York City, any kid that you think is gonna benefit from the conversations that we are sharing here today, please share the links. It's gonna be the consistent link. So this webinar link that you're on right now is gonna be this consistent link for all of our webinars going forward. And with that, I'm gonna kick it over to Mr. Barnett, who's gonna introduce our ambassador, Mr. Ajani Patterson.
Good morning, Eagle Nation. As Mr. Mead said, for those that don't know me, my name is Aaron Barnett, Director of Strategic Partnerships and Mentoring Services for the Eagle Academy Foundation. I've had the pleasure to work with a group of phenomenal young men who we call the Eagle Ambassadors, who represent each of your schools, and they will be part of this weekly town hall, and they will be asking questions of our guests on behalf of you. And so I just want to quickly introduce them before we get into the ambassador that will introduce our guest speaker. Just wave really quick, gentlemen. From Eagle Queens, we have Troy Williams. From Eagle Harlem, we have Mr. Justice Combes. From Eagle Newark, we have Prince Williamson. Also from Eagle Queens, we have Tyron Simmons. And unfortunately, gentlemen, we could not have our ambassadors from the Bronx or Staten Island on today, but they will be on next week. And so let me introduce the ambassador that is going to introduce our guest speaker, Mr. Bowman, out of Eagle, Brooklyn, Senior Ajani Patterson.
All right. Good morning, guys. I'm Ajani Patterson. I'm currently a senior at Eagle Academy for Young Men. Today's guest speaker is Jamaal Bowman. Jamaal Bowman was born and raised in New York City. He spent his early years in public housing and later rent control apartments. He didn't have much growing up, but his mother provided him with all that he needed: love, a stable family, and a sense of community. It was through his experience growing up that he decided to dedicate his life to serving others, working to become the founding principal of one of the best public middle schools in the city. Mr. Bowman has effectively fought for teachers, students, and families for 20 years. After seeing the failure in the education system, he founded Cornerstone Academy for Social Action, located in Baychester neighborhood of the Bronx. CASA is an innovative public school with a strong emphasis on students' voice, holistic education, cultural awareness, and love. Through his work in education, he has seen firsthand how low-income families are locked out of opportunities by a system that is rigged for wealthy and privileged few. With his work as an advocate and principal, he has seen the results of inadequate housing, homelessness, mental health, and racist immigration system. The school-to-prison pipeline, food deserts, and trauma-filled environments. Although a successful educator, Mr. Bowman felt he could make an even deeper impact in our community by turning to politics. During his past June primary for United States House of Representatives in New York 16th Congressional District, he successfully defeated 15-term incumbent Eliot Inglis. The platform he ran on has been described as anti-poverty, anti-racist, with support from housing, criminal justice reforms, education, Medicare for all, and Green New Deals. On behalf of all my Eagle brothers from across New York City and Newark, New Jersey, I would like to welcome our future U.S. Congressman, Mr. Jamaal Bowman.
Brother welcome, Patterson, thank you so much for that warm introduction. First of all, love the bow tie, feeling the bow tie. You are killing the bow tie game right now. Please keep that up, young man. Brother Meade, it's such a pleasure to see you, man. It's an honor. I haven't seen you in about 10 or 12 years as a new up-and-coming principal. So it's an honor to circle back to you. And Mr. Patterson, that was a great introduction. I appreciate that. But that introduction sounds a little too polished to really describe sort of who I am, my story, and where I come from. So yes, I lived in public housing. I lived in East River Projects on 105th Street and First Avenue in Manhattan. And I lived with my grandmother at that time until I was about 7 years old when my grandmother passed away. And when she passed away, I had to move full-time with my mom, who had to work to take care of me and my three sisters. And because she had to work, she didn't really have the time to walk me to school. So at 7, 8 years old, it was my responsibility to walk myself to school 13 blocks from 92nd Street and 2nd Avenue to 101st and 1st, I believe it was, where I went to school in Metro North at PS 50. So you could imagine a little 8-year-old kid walking 13 blocks in Manhattan. Pretty scary time, but it was something I had to do because we had no other options. I was raised by a single mom along with my three sisters. My mom worked in the post office, raised us on a postal worker salary because of state policy that allowed her to pay rent in alignment with what her salary was. So we had a great opportunity there. I went to public schools my entire life, and I have to tell you all, I wasn't always the best student. I wasn't one of those students who was super driven to get the highest grades possible in my class. I was pretty much a clown in school. I went to school to have a good time and to mess with the girls and to play sports. I was not one of those super, super polished students. And I also got into a lot of trouble in school. I was very sort of angry because my father wasn't around. And it wasn't just that he wasn't around. It was the fact that he would often tell me he was coming to see me and he would not show up. So that level of dishonesty led to me developing a certain amount of anger and rage as I went through school. And as a result of that, I got into a lot of trouble, you know, while going to school growing up. So in junior high school and in high school, I was suspended from school multiple times because I would get into fights, I would cut class, and I would do a lot of things that were more harmful to me ultimately than it was to my environment. And I share those stories to let y'all know that I came from a place that wasn't as polished as that introduction sounded. I came from a place where if I didn't make a decision at some point in my life to get away from the peer pressure and get away from the streets, I don't know where I would be in this moment. And that decision was made after 10th grade when I failed every single class in the 10th grade. I decided to go live with my father in New Jersey and get away from what was happening in New York City at the time, which, you know, I'm 44 years old. So I grew up in, you know, pretty much during the crack cocaine epidemic and during the AIDS epidemic. And, you know, crack cocaine had a huge impact on my family. My oldest sister was addicted to crack cocaine. And as a result, like, it just really, it was something my family is actually still recovering from today, all these years later, if you could believe that. And I had many friends who had parents who were addicted to drugs, and many friends who got caught up in the street life who were drug dealers, drug users. And some of them were murdered, you know, as young as, you know, 18, 19 years old. Some of them are still in prison, you know, doing 20, 30 year sentences for being involved in a drug game. And some of them suffered from mental distress to the point where, you know, they became victims of suicide and they died by suicide as young as 18 years old. So I share all that with you because I want you to know the personal experiences that shaped me into the person I am today, but into the person that ultimately became an educator. And as it was mentioned before, you know, I worked in the school system for 20 years. I served as an elementary school teacher in the South Bronx, a high school dean of students at the High School for Arts and Technology, and a middle school principal in the Northeast Bronx. And one of the reasons why I pivoted from being a dean to being a principal is because, you know, when you work in our schools, you see not just how underfunded and under-resourced our schools are, you see how underfunded and under-resourced our communities are. Neglect from lack of community centers, lack of libraries, lack of museums. You know, if you're Black and brown in New York or Black and brown anywhere in the country, you live with less resources. And that's completely unacceptable. So after working in education for 8 years, and part of my job as the Dean of Students at the High School for Arts and Technology was to monitor metal detectors as kids walked into school. And for me, you know, as a Black man in New York City, Black man in America, I just felt like I was part of a criminalization system where we were criminalizing Black and brown students walking through metal detectors, even though they hadn't done anything wrong. And at that time, the mayor was Michael Bloomberg, and his justification, excuse me, my seat keeps messing up, and his justification for putting more metal detectors and more police in our schools was that our kids were violent. So they would take one violent incident and generalize it to all the kids who were going to this school and to multiple schools throughout the city. And if you know anything about MLK High School, it's right across the street from LaGuardia High School. So when you contrast the two, one school is mostly Black and Latino, one school is mostly white. The Black and Latino school has metal detectors, the white school doesn't. One is specialized, one is considered just regular public. And you have this sort of internalized racism that's a part of the system and becomes part of our kids. So for me, that was like my tipping point. Enough is enough. I didn't want to be anyone's correction officer. I wanted to be an educator. And I wanted to create a school that tapped into the unlimited potential of our kids. Our kids are brilliant. They have unlimited potential. They come with energy. They come ready to learn despite their experiences. And our system has failed them. And as I've been in education for 20 years, you realize it's not just the education system that's failing. It's the political and economic system that's failing. It's our elected officials that haven't centered our children and haven't centered those who are most vulnerable in our society. They continue to be more aligned with corporate interests and the wealthy elite and continue to ignore our children, our babies, our families, and looking at how they struggle. So how can kids thrive when their communities are neglected, when they're dealing with housing insecurity, when they're dealing with food insecurity, when they're dealing with asthma and environmental justice? How can they survive and thrive in those circumstances when they go to underfunded schools that are overcrowded and under-resourced? And by contrast, when you look at communities like Scarsdale and Bronxville and parts of Riverdale, class sizes are smaller, they have more resources, and they get a lot more done because of that circumstance. So I decided to run for office because I wanted to make transformative change, not just in education, but in our communities. And I wanted to use myself as an example, as a Black man that came from challenging circumstances, to show people what's possible when you have faith, when you have the power of belief, and when you have a community that supports what you're trying to do. So, you know, for me, the tipping point came in 2017, 2018, when 34 children died within the K-12 school system in the Bronx, and 17 died via suicide. And right near my school, my middle school in the Bronx in Co-op City, a ninth grader who was bullied went to the top of a building after school and jumped off the building. And in New Rochelle, also in the district, two girls got into an argument. One pulls out a knife, stabs the other, and kills her. So when you have children killing each other and children killing themselves, you have a crisis of epic proportions. And our elected officials weren't making the connections between those outcomes, trauma, poverty, and bad policy that comes from Washington. So for me, it was like enough is enough. My organizing wasn't enough, being a principal wasn't enough. So we explored this run for office. And let me just say one thing before I go into the run. We looked at the data before we made that decision. Elliot Engel had been in office for 31 years. In the primary, during the primary in 2018, only 30,000 people voted in that primary. There are 350,000 registered Democrats in this district. So that's less than 10%. And he won with 22,000 votes. So this is a person making trillion-dollar decisions for our country, our communities, and the globe, because America's a global leader, making trillion-dollar decisions with 22,000 votes. For me, that was unacceptable. So I said to myself, I could knock on 22,000 doors myself and beat him in the primary. But luckily, I didn't have to do that. We were endorsed by over 60 grassroots organizations and individuals. We were endorsed by the Justice Democrats, their first endorsement in New York since AOC. We built a diverse coalition across race, class, religion, focused on progressive values, dealing with racial and economic injustice in all its forms. And we were able to win a historic election by 16 points. Now, you got to understand, when you run an election, you know, usually these elections are won by maybe 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 points. If you win by 7 points, that's a huge win. We won by 16 points. So that was a resounding victory for us. And, you know, we won, my district is broken up between the Bronx and Westchester. We won both the Bronx side and the Westchester side. And we won areas that people didn't think we had a chance to win. Why? Because we connected with the people. We went right into the projects and people that are usually ignored. We knocked on those doors. We had conversations. We listened. We learned. We engaged them, because it's not just about voting me into office and allowing me to thrive when I get to office. This is about us as a community going to office together. And in order to make that happen, I need to have everybody at the table. We need all voices involved. Because if we don't take this opportunity to grow this movement and build political power in the district and across the country, we're going to have more Donald Trumps in office. And we're going to have more Republicans in the office who care more about fascism and power and oppression than they care about democracy. So, and this is not, so Democrats are more aligned with democracy, but Democrats have made mistakes as well in terms of serving our community. So for me as a Democrat, it's about making sure that Democrats are more progressives and they're doing everything they in their power to meet the needs of the people in our district and across the country. So that's my story. And the biggest part of that story that I want to leave you all with, especially our young people, I want you to never forget your unlimited power and your unlimited potential to make transformative change in your community. And it doesn't have to be running for office. It could be supporting someone else who ran for office. We had thousands of volunteers on our campaign. Those volunteers were doing phone banking, text banking, writing letters, knocking on doors, doing everything in their power to help us win. We made 1.2 million phone calls in our campaign, which is unheard of for a congressional race. And it's key for you to understand that, because you know, when you call certain people one time and you ask them if they're going to vote for us, they may say yes, but they may forget they got a lot going on. So it's about calling 2, 3, 4 times to make sure they get themselves to the polls and support our campaign so we could grow this movement. So you are all a part of a movement. You are all living through a year that's going to be written about, you know, 20, 30, 200 years from now as a tipping point in American history. You are all a part of it. So whatever your passion is, whatever you love, whatever your intuition is, whatever issue you care about, dive deep into that issue and become the best you can be within that issue, but become part of the system where you can make transformative change. And that happens through organizing, strategizing, and mobilizing, and through building political and economic power. So peace and love to you all. It's a real pleasure to be here with you all, and I look forward to whatever questions you have.
Well said, man. Well said. A lot of diamonds in there. A lot of great things said, and we appreciate those words. So we're going to open this to questions now. We could start it off with, what is the biggest change you would like to make in your community if you were successfully elected into office on November 3rd?
We need reparations. We need reparations for Black people in this country, and we need reparations within Black and Brown communities. And what reparations look like to me is not just cash payments to people's pockets, but making sure people have access to housing, access to jobs, access to universal healthcare, access to entrepreneurial opportunities, fully funding our public schools, access to developing their own communities in their own image. I mean, when you look at places like Manhattan and Brooklyn and China and Chicago and different parts of this country, we've built magnificent cities and infrastructure, but we've never been able to do that in our own image as Black and Brown people because we've never been fully invested in and supported. And while other communities like the Japanese community, the Jewish community and others have gotten reparations, and rightly so, African Americans in our country have never received reparations. So we're fighting for reparations and more spending in our community so that we could build the infrastructures in our own image and become collectively determined as a community. That would show the country and the world that we're getting over and being serious about dealing with institutional racism, which is the second point I want to make. Institutional racism lives everywhere in our community. It's exhibited in police brutality, in mass incarceration, in miseducation, in economic inequality, in environmental justice, and so many other areas. So this is a chance for us to rebuild our nation in alignment with being a post-racist society. Racism will always be there, but it's on our government and our elected officials to push us forward to a place where we never have a Donald Trump again.
Thank you for that. Mr. Bowman, I understand that you've been a witness and just from air and sight that many young people has had mental issues. And in these times, we understand that mental health is something very important and a lot of people struggling through it. What, if elected, what would you do to help mental health in school?
It's a great point. So in our schools, and just to give you quick background, so when I opened my school, I didn't hire a dean of students for discipline, and I didn't hire an assistant principal for discipline. I hired a social worker and a school counselor so that we could become a trauma-informed school and help our children with the mental distress that they may be dealing with or going through, but to also help with mediation when any conflict arises between students and other students. So we hire a school counselor and a social worker. And our schools need more of that. We need more counselors, more social workers, and more school psychologists. But we also need more programming. So when we talk about fully funding public schools, what we're talking about is we need more theater programs. We need more arts programs. We need more sports programs. We need more music programs. We need more nature programs. We need to bring the multiple intelligences into our schools. We also need our schools to be culturally responsive. So Black and Brown people are learning about Black and Brown history and culture and how Black and Brown people have made contributions to world history. That's important to building a sense of self-esteem and self-worth in our Black and Latino communities so that kids can grow up with a certain sense of pride and dignity, and then they're able to thrive once they graduate from our schools. So this is all incredibly key. And it's not just in our schools, it's in our communities as well. We need the dignity of jobs. So not just jobs where people could feel proud and dignified within those jobs. Dignity of housing, not living in housing that's dilapidated and neglected. We need to support dignified housing, dignified communities and other social structures to help people develop holistically as they grow up. So it's a new vision for the country, focused on public health, focused on public safety, and focused on holistic health and learning so that people can grow up as well-developed and nurtured as they possibly can.
Thank you very much. You talked about playing football in college, and we have many scholar athletes on this line. I'm also a scholar athlete. I play soccer. So, like, what advice would you give for we, the scholar athletes, to also be successful in life? Because, like, we see many of our stars on our TV stations and everything. So what advice would you give for us to also be as great as the people we see on our TV stations?
Well, if you're passionate about the sport that you're playing, you have to work your butt off every day to be the best athlete you could be in that particular sport. You have to identify your weaknesses and work really hard to strengthen those weaknesses. So I played football, but I played a lot of basketball as well. And, you know, I'm right-handed in basketball. So, you know, my layups and my shots with my right hand. So I would just go out to the court and just work on my left hand for hours and hours and hours and hours, just so I could make sure I could go left with the same confidence that I would go right. And that helped when I played basketball. But I also would say that, you know, when you play your sport, you know, my goal was to become professional. And I think that's a lot of our goals. We want to be professional athletes. But even if you don't make it there, you develop so many skills through sports that are transferable to other areas. So discipline, hard work, conscientiousness, health. I mean, it's incredibly healthy to be an athlete. Teamwork, cooperation, dealing with success and failure in the right way. Sports teaches you all of that. I would also advise you to develop interests outside of sports. So when you're not, you know, being a scholar athlete, what else are you interested in? You know, is it music? Is it arts? Is it pottery? Is it whatever it is? And the last thing I will say is, you know, I would say to everyone on this call, you should be consistently reading at least one book, maybe two or three books at a time. Like, I can't tell you how much reading just elevates your mind and your consciousness. Reading books is like steroids for the brain. And when you read outside of school, books that you choose, you take yourself to a whole nother level. And one of the poll questions was a question around, where do you get your news from, information from? And most people said social media. And I think what was last was conversations with your friends. And that shouldn't be the case. Like, you should be, your friends and you should be constantly reading things and then talking about them, so you could have a clear understanding of what's happening. This is, it's critical thinking. You can't read and be in isolation with your own thoughts or whatever's trending. Whatever's trending doesn't mean it's actually true, or it's true from your point of view. So reading and having dialogue on a variety of issues as a scholar athlete or for anyone is incredibly important.
Oh, good morning, Mr. Bowman. First, I would like to say thank you for sharing your story and expressing your desires and helping not only us people of color, but the community in general. So from reading your bio, it says that you are a fan of the Wu-Tang Clan. So growing up, so my question is, who was your favorite member of the Wu-Tang Clan? And also, how has the group influenced you in a way?
Great question. Favorite member is the RZA. He's the one that brought the clan together. He was their main producer. He's also a dope MC. So the RZA was my favorite one. Other than that, man, I mean, I don't know. They're all super dope. So, you know, I can't really differentiate many of the others. I'm a big Inspector Deck fan. The Only Built for Cuban Links album was phenomenal. So they're just an incredible group. Hip hop in general, as a culture, growing up helped me to find my identity as a Black man in this country. I wasn't learning about Black history and culture in our schools. I was learning about it through hip hop. And I grew up through what I call the golden age of hip hop. So my favorite artists were Eric B and Rakim, X-Clan, KRS-One, Boogie Down Production, Big Daddy Kane, Brand Nubian, Chuck D, Public Enemy. So these were my forefathers, if you will, of the culture. And they taught me so much about Black history and culture and myself and how America works. And it was just like, it was almost like a curriculum in my history that I would go through. So in terms of my sense of identity, not just Wu-Tang, but hip hop overall, you know, helped me to be secure in who I was, which helped me to communicate more effectively with the world beyond my community.
Thank you, Brother Bowman. My favorite member was Ghostface. Let me just add that. But we have our last question from scholar Tyron Simmons, representing Eagle Queens.
Hi, thank you so much for sharing your inspirational story with us, Mr. Bowman. We applaud the drive that you have to make a true difference in our community. What charge do you have for us as an Eagle community to make a similar difference at our age right now?
Man, change the world right now. No hesitation. Do not wait. Do not make any excuses. Do not look for someone else to do it. You step up and do it yourself. You take on the responsibility of growing exponentially every day into your best self so you can have a transformative impact wherever you go in this world. Every issue that's plaguing our community, the 725 people on this call right now can transform that issue. If you have a rally around police brutality and 725 people show up, that's going to make national and international news and begin to shift towards changing the world. If you want to fully fund our public schools and 725 people show up, that will make international news. So it's about organizing, strategizing, and mobilizing around the issues that matter most, but it's also about you following your intuition and your instincts and your passion and developing yourself each and every day so you could be a transformative change agent. The world needs you. The world needs you right now. The world is suffering. The world is struggling. We have a political system that led to Donald Trump being our president, a clear white nationalist, and led to Republicans having control over Senate houses and Congress and emboldening white nationalist groups to try to begin to wage a race war against us. This is what's happening in our country now. In a global pandemic that this incompetent president didn't handle correctly, which is disproportionately killing us. But my question to all of you and my challenge to all of you is, what are we going to do about it? What are we going to do each and every day to make sure we're putting ourselves in the best position to make transformative change? And going back to the question about mental health, which is a key question, there's a lifestyle that we all can live that will sharpen our mental acumen and our emotional stability and our ability to make transformative change. So everything from diet to exercise, to what we're reading, to who we're surrounding ourselves with, to what thoughts we allow to creep into our head versus the ones we kick out. Like, this is all part of consistent development over time. The world needs you, man. Not just your community, not just this city, state, country, but the world needs us to be excellent, to be awesome, and to make transformative change and do it now. There's no need to wait. And I don't want to put too much pressure on the young people here. You know, I know we have some freshmen, sophomores, probably like, what am I talking about? You could still be a kid and have fun. You can do that. But separate your time between 50% fun and 50% serious work in making transformative change in the world today. So we need you for so many issues. Whatever your intuition is and your passion is, follow that and help us move the country in the right direction.
Phenomenal. Congressman, thank we have Mr. Banks. Okay, got Banks.
No, I just want to say thank you, Brother Bowman. This was an extremely powerful message to our young men. I thank you for accepting the invitation to be with us. And you are the embodiment of what we want all of our young men to strive to be, whether it's in politics or whatever it is. But it's that strive for excellence, no matter what your beginnings and no matter what the experiences that you have gone through. Can't thank you enough, man. We really appreciate you.
Pleasure to be with you, Brother Banks. Thank you for your mentorship and for showing me the way. What the people on this call may not know is when I was a young teacher, Brother Banks founded the first Eagle Academy. And I would watch Brother Banks from afar, even before I met him, and watch the work he was doing, not just being the founder of Eagle Academy, but community development overall. And I would go to forums and events that he would do with other leaders in our community. And his example and his embodiment and his vision and his mentorship from afar, I didn't even meet him in person yet, really inspired me as a young teacher to do more throughout my community. And that's why I'm in this position today. So thank you, Brother Banks, for your example over the last 20 years.
God bless you. Appreciate that.
All right. Y'all have a good day. Peace and love, family. Stay safe.
Peace and love. Yes. Bye-bye.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, everybody from the Eagle Academy Network. Thank you so much for making sure that we're here. Brother Banks, thank you for being the leader you are and stewarding this whole thing and getting this whole ball moving. Brother Bowman, who was with us, I hope you gentlemen were listening. And as everyone received their thank yous, the gentlemen, you ambassadors, you showed out for our network in a way in beautiful fashion. So gentlemen, you deserve some applause and some recognition in this moment for representing this great network as beautifully as you did. 2020, I'm looking at you, AP Bringley, right? 2020 was the Infinity Gauntlet Thanos snap we didn't even see coming. So we don't have a tomorrow. Brother Bowman was correct. We got right now for change. We got right now for change. Gentlemen, you are the Avengers to be assembled right now. And we thank you for being there. We thank you for coming to the call. And we thank all of our hundreds of participants for joining us today, because all of us have the ability to be the change that Brother Bowman has given us the charge to be right now in today. Have a great rest of your day. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you again for joining us. We'll see you next week.